us introduce Paddy Duffy. Who's going to speak on living in fast and slow landscapes, first of the geography and history of the new congregation today. Paddy.
Thanks very much, Tom. And it's great to have such a distinguished audience here today, and delighted to be here. And I kind of think maybe I'm under here on the false pretense, because it's kind of marginally historical geography. I think it definitely wouldn't qualify under any traditional definition of historical geography. But what I want to talk about is, as it says here, living in slow and fast landscapes. It's just a general idea that I'm teasing out, which is based on the notion that, in a general sense, landscape experience has speeded up over the past century. Diversity in the experience of landscape has been produced by different modes of transport, from routine local movements to long-distance movements. The notion of slow and fast landscapes was suggested by my father's diary, so that's the cue that I'm basing the whole idea on. My father left me all his diaries beginning in 1932, and so they begin in 1932, and over the following decades, they helped to illustrate, I think, among lots of other things, they helped to illustrate the impact of a mobility transition from a predominantly pedestrian world, which was a rural world largely, as you can see, of slow landscapes to a world of fast landscapes as travel speeded up throughout the 20th century. So it's a personal memoir of the transition from walking and cycling to his first car and the way it changed almost literally overnight the nature of the relationship with landscape. The ultimate manifestation of this experience, of course, as you all know, this experience of landscape and travel and movement and so on is best exemplified in the utterly functional virtual landscapes of Satnav and so on. And I just want to, this is a little obvious.
Before I got my garment,
but you don't get off with it, I'm sure.
The final part of a journey could be a real headache.
It's a lovely place. How can you get yourself down the double road? You find Mr. Murphy's house right about halfway down, and right before you see it, to the third right, left. Look at the red carpet still there. Isn't it one story area in that pretty terrace? In by a big hedge. Actually, the one with the dog.
Need better directions? Garmin satnavs with locate postcodes can pinpoint your destination.
So basically, I haven't heard it recently on television or radio. But it kind of sums up the contrast between the slow and fast world. But the slow world of verbal direction, landmarks and so on and so forth, and the fast world of satnav. So what I wanted to introduce with the video, John mentioned to me that I've got a lot of slides and I have, so they're only background video, and I'm going to flick through them very quickly. But I was going to do like a clip, video clip as well, which would show the walking world, the cycling world, the car world, really, the automobile transport. And the walking world, of course, 3 miles an hour roughly on average, where we can zoom in on flowers and leaves on the roadside as we pass fields and hills, trees, stone walls, house and gardens, we see the colours in the landscape. Feel the heat of the sun, hear the bird song, blah, blah, blah. And so on. The voices of people encountered on the road, conversation. These are all kind of senses that I can extract from the diaries. This constant interaction at a very, very local scale with the landscape and so on. And you could illustrate that in the video. Then you could change the gear to a bicycle, which happened as well in the 1930s. A bicycle when things speeded up and there was less of that intimate interaction, and then of course to the car when you get the car and you get an increasingly less tactile engagement, insulated from the wind and rain, insulated from the bird song, insulated from people encountered on the road as well. So it's a very different kind of sense of landscape that I'm talking about in that context. So the diaries from the 30s, 40s and 50s especially illustrate very well the nature of slow landscapes produced at a local scale and a mode of routine daily travel, which epitomized similar landscape experiences in much of rural Europe at the same time, I suspect, probably not at the same time in North America. Just very quickly, that's my father on his bicycle in 1934, 35, heading off to school. He was a school teacher in the morning. And these are just extracts from the diary, and I really don't have time to go into them very quickly, but there are hundreds and hundreds of ways in which you can, in January 1934, and it's all about movement over in this place, Cornhill, in somebody's house, very wet. School opened today, went over to Cornhill again, Vera Friend's house, over in Boyd's till this wet day, over in another house the following day, and so on. It's all about movement from around the local place. This is a day in July, a Sunday in July 1935, talking to so-and-so, lots of visitors, silent home, went with this Koenig and his friend and so on to the bog for a dance. They had a party in the bog, gramophone, singing, dancing, then went to Mulligan's for a house dance there. I'll come back to the significance of that in a moment. Again, August, over, back, across, moving around all the time, by foot or by bicycle, essentially. So it's all about local intensive interaction. Cycled over the road, down to so-and-so's house, walked to Rosie's, on ahead, went so-and-so on the road. Actually, it's a nice little thing. I met this guy here on the road and he sang Sweet Londonderry for us on the roadside. Then they came home with me and then others in the kitchen doing tricks, which was something, games, card games, tricks, etc., etc., etc. So it's all about activity at a local level. So it's clear that local places were known in intense and intimate detail as a result of the daily routines of walking and cycling. And for farmers on horseback, not on horseback, on horse cart, slow journeys through fields and roads. Part of this dense sensuous knowledge was not just knowledge of the material and cultural landscape, but also intimate familiarity with the people and families in the community, with local life, customs, traditions, etc., etc. So you get, this is the material landscape, okay, that we're all familiar with, of fields and hills and so on and so forth. Okay, 1930s, about around that particular time. And also, and that material landscape, of course, is named intimately. In this case, a lot of the fields are named, were named. So every field, all those little rectilinear fields, rectangular fields that we saw, have a very material reality. I grew up in this landscape as well because my father's happened. I grew up in the same place, in the same sort of diary landscape, if you like. So I remember when I was growing up, the place was just littered with names. I'll just give you some of them. The Dummies Lane, Priest's Road, the Ghost Bush, Clapham Road, Marquis Bray, Lennon's Lane, the Five Crossroads, the Blind Man's Bridge, the Crooked Bridge, Scotch Corner, the Bog Road, the Baker's Field, the Green Gates. These were all landmarks in within about 2 miles, 1 mile of our house. You know? So those with field names to them represent the reality of that landscape. Face-to-face encounters solidified the local landscape experience. And I mean, I was going to quote, well, I don't really have time to quote Rebecca Solnit from California, of all places, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, walked through the South, walked through Cork and Kerry, and she described our trip. In one little passage, she says, I walked from Ballydehob to Bantry, across the bridge over Bonnachanan River, where it enters Roaring Water Bay, past Knockbrough, Knocknafooken, Cusan, Ballyban, Barnadeehy, Letterlicky Bridge, across the Durrow, Holly Hill, Camondel. She mentioned all these because from California she thought this was extraordinary. So a fine collection of names for a 10-mile walk, the townland names. And then she talked about the low stone walls, the hedgerows full of flowers, owl clover, buttercups, violets, ferns, bluebells, fuchsias, foxglove, etc., etc., etc. Hugely textured kind of reality of landscape at that slow walking pace. And I remember the 50s as a transitional period in terms of local transport. I remember just the end of the horse cart era, you know, the rumbling wheels of horse carts and the farmers trampling past the house, sitting up on the side of the cart, talking to everybody as they walk by and, you know, surveying the world. I remember that passing and then being succeeded by tractors and of course the gradual, fairly rapid increase of cars into the 1960s. So you had the material landscape, you also had the social landscape, and this is a map of the social landscape of my home place here that I used elsewhere, but this is the house that I'm talking about here, which is a C, which is a K house. So it was a house for visitors, for dancing and so on, and then there's several of those around the neighborhood. And so this map is an attempt to show the farms, fields, houses, and then the kind of connections between the houses, the social linkages and so on that were there. So it's a social landscape of family names and nicknames, intense communal interaction manifested in house visiting, dancing and so on. almost every night of the week in our house there were men, young men, as in the diaries, my father's age, all, you know, in, because he had three sisters, my three aunts, and they were the attraction, I suppose, and there was dancing in the house and so on and so forth. So as an illustration, but I'll give you another little clip here. This is actually from the National Geographic magazine in Kerry, and I think it's a posed image of house dancing in the 1930s. But it does give a sense of, you know, the oil lamp on the wall there, no electricity. It gives a sense of the smallness of these houses. And in this case, this is the parish that I'm talking about, my own parish here, which is
houses about here. And this is 1936, when my father went to 77 dances for Dardy. The map actually shows his dancing throughout the year, as in very little in the winter time, and then as we come through the summer, lots and lots of dances that he went to. But they were all in the local area, except for the army. The odd ones here out in Castlelaney or Monaghan, but mostly in within about 3 miles of the house, these dances were attended by walking, mostly cycling, within cycling distance. And this is the one here. These were all the dances of 1936 that happened in our house. In fact, no, when I say dancing, I mean parties, really. There were parties, maybe, but there were maybe up to 20 people at these things, and or more in some cases, 20 to 30. And I really can't understand how they, I still don't understand how they managed in those spaces. So other manifestations of that localness and that intense interaction were things like, you know, farmers, 1940s, this is a ploughing match, but horses were the main thing. So farmers walked the fields. They walked the fields around all the fields. They knew the shapes and the texture of the fields. They went to the blacksmith's forge was a kind of an important meeting place and for social interaction. The road bowls, in fact, in Monaghan, road bowling in Armagh and Armagh and Cork, there are the three parts of Ireland where you get this road bowling. And this is about, I think this is the 1940s. Obviously, it's heavily, traffic isn't too heavy, but you need clearly a slow, on-traffic landscape for road bowling, football, and so on. So, I mean, walking, talking, cycling, horses, farming, ploughing, road bowls, church-going rituals at Footstool, and many, many, many. Loads, even when in the 50s when I was growing up in the 60s, loads of service and so on, most of them not going on, and funerals of course. So my father cycled to school every day, and the thing about cycling to school is that go to school direct, which was about 3 miles he cycled through all the weathers, and then coming home, he reached the school in about 25 minutes maybe. Sometimes it took him 2 or 3 hours to get home because he was constantly stopping on the way. He was meeting people on the road, he was calling into houses, he was, you know, and that was it, movement and so on the road, people walking and talking and so on. That was very important. This just illustrates, there were cars, okay, and this is a Hackney car. There were maybe in the parish there might have been 2 or 3 cars belonging to young entrepreneurs, and in this case it's a big American. This car here, I think one of the diary, there's one record of going to a dance in Castlelaney, and I think, or going to the cinema, going to the film in Castlelaney. I think there were 14 people in the car. I mean, it is a big car, but I think it was heavily overloaded. But, so the car would have been hired for special occasions. All right. So, all of these then display, so that this kind of intense, this interaction going on at the slow landscape then is about feeling, a felt landscape in which the viewer takes part in the landscape, walking, talking and cycling in it. And then we can look at the transition. As train travel, of course, happened, you're all probably saying, historians are all saying, yes, there were trains in the 1840s and 50s, and so there were, of course. So that was the first big speed up. But trains are a very particular kind of form of motion, and as Willie Smith told me the other day, trains, in fact, themselves are like long linear landscapes because there was so much activity and interaction and meeting and walking up and down carriages and people, local communities and so on, met in the local trains in many cases in the west of Ireland and whatnot. But so I'm going to park trains, if you excuse the pun for a moment, and just say that it was a gradual transition to mass ownership of cars in the 50s and 60s in Ireland that transformed the experience and embodiment of landscape. Rather than the slow rumbling horse carts with the driver sitting up surveying all he passed, the car introduced a new sound to the landscape and the range of movement expanded. So you had the beginnings of commuter landscapes in the 1960s. The consequence of that was a transformation in the relationship with place as movement speeded up and expanded, and a transformation in the landscape itself to accommodate changing modes and mobilities. My father bought his first car in 1940, just at the outbreak of war, and then that was the end of the car because petrol was rationed. But the car was interesting because almost overnight it began a transformation in the experience of landscape. As well as expanding the orbit of travel, it insulated him and more of his neighbours from tangible experience of the local landscape. With the speeding up of travel and expanded horizons of living, local landscape detail was edited out and has been for the last 40, 50 years. if not deleted completely, and rendered increasingly obsolete and bypassed as people took to cars, or maybe farmers took to tractors as well, and reached further beyond the local across regional and national landscapes. Today, most travellers' experience is of house-high hedges whizzing past, or empty fields and placeless kind of landscapes. Fast landscapes. As the car became more and more pervasive through the 20th century, the landscape was altered to accommodate faster transport, obviously. The obvious things are new roads, highways, road networks. Road widths increased, bends were removed, bridges were removed, better surfaces created, road markings, cat's eyes, all the things, all the business, all the stuff that went with the 20th century fast landscape. It's a universal experience of living in the 20th century, especially in North America, where it happened first, of course, and where I think Jeffersonian grid in the Midwest and the West facilitated fast landscape, you know. The rectilinear, easy to read landscape of North America, of the United States, with this impersonal, or somebody called it, impersonal mechanical logic, rendered it easily legible and facilitated rapid travel and all the great road movies. I mean, it's no accident that they all happen in North America. And there, and here, now in Ireland, Europe was in Ireland, landscapes were designed to be viewed at 60 miles an hour or 100 kilometers an hour. The Blue Ridge Parkway in the United States, in North Carolina, Virginia, started in the mid-1930s, so it was very early. But that was the first American highway landscape designed for leisurely driving and viewing at a distance, begun in the mid-1930s. The motorway landscape illustrated here is obviously a legacy of the Celtic Tiger in Ireland, and it's a classic, it's a typical kind of international, placeless kind of channel going through the countryside where you just speed through and everything looks the same, and I mean, we lose our orientation. France, interestingly, has made an attempt in a classic, stylish French fashion to give a local flavour to these highways and motorways and so on, and have these, you know, these tremendously interesting. So, I mean, you're all familiar with, you know, these, if you've been to France driving, it's quite difficult to photograph them, so I was taking my life in my hands here because you're flying along, you have to wait for it to get in traffic. But you can see these, they try and capture a flavour of the local landscape or the regional landscape that you're passing through. Some of them are quite artistic and very attractive. Faster landscapes resulted in field names, etc., being forgotten, becoming obsolete. So all that old landscape that I showed you is essentially farmers on their tractors don't go near the fields anymore, so the fields are gone. Farming experienced this mobility transition from slow to fast landscapes, from horses plodding through the fields to tractors racing around the local landscape. Nobody walks the landscape anymore. Michael Viney had a quote, had a little report in the Irish Times a few years ago, where he said, nobody walks the landscape anymore. He said about his neighbourhood in Mayo. He said 30 years before that, flocks of sheep used to be walked past his house with the farmer and a couple of dogs. He said now, he says they're driven past the gate. Now he says they proceed routinely ahead of the farmer's car. And he says the dog sometimes sits in the passenger seat. So it's a quite different experience from what it was. Okay, and then of course we have the other modifications to the landscape, signage, you know, everywhere. It gets more and more complicated as things speed up, instructions and codes and symbols. And this is something that should be made illegal. This is the one in Ballyhome, I think it is, in County Kerry. It's a disaster of a landscape or a signage. But more and more rural inhabitants, then, as they invested in cars, their engagement with local landscapes changed as they moved further afield, forgetting the local detail and so on. Okay. On the local detail, last year I was driving in Italy, and the sat nav that I played earlier on, you can actually put in the names of the roads when you need it. So I could have, refer to my via here, you could have, you know, the sat nav would tell you left turn at via, excuse my French, but Italian, via Valperga, Caluso, or cross the roundabout to Corso Vittorio Emanuele II, or via Trapattoni, whatever you're having. But in fact, I didn't want all that detail. I mean, I didn't want to know what roads we were in because it was so confusing. All I wanted was the basic turn left, turn right, cross the roundabout, take the first jump, just get out. So I was really into a fast landscape, a placeless kind of landscape as far as I was concerned. Finally, if I can just talk about recovering slow landscapes. Like the slow food movement, there's been a growing interest in recovering, well, that's the fast landscape I talked about earlier. It's kind of amazing, you know, with the image you get, just this disembodied sort of placeless image. In some places in Ireland, you may be familiar with this, there's been a revolution in the last 10 years where local communities actually, you know, engraving the name of their townland, the little townland, on stone or some other landmark in their neighborhood. There's loads of these, hundreds of these popping up, especially in the West and in other parts of rural Ireland, a kind of pride in locality again, where people are rediscovering their local landscape. But now, like the slow food movement, there's been a growing interest in recovering the slow landscape experience, probably best exemplified in tourism. Using different modes of transport, new and different landscapes can be revealed as we embody the role of walker, pedestrian, cyclist, or driver. Walkers, backpackers, cyclists can now experience slow landscapes as a kind of commodity of culture and heritage. Early in this Car magazine last year, as an article on Bruges, which says, wander over the little humpback bridges that have spanned glassy canals for centuries and you discover a world of ancient almshouses, slender cobbled streets, tall gabled historic bars, cafes, eminently walkable. It's car-free centre where the only sounds are the peal of church bells and the clip-clop of horses' hooves as carriages rumble over cobblestones. I mean, that's a reaching back to a pre-automobile landscape and a sense of landscape, I think. I just know that Colin Farrell, I think you saw Bruges, you saw the Bruges. Colin Farrell didn't have much time in Bruges. This is quite different to the organic relationship of the pre-war diaries. It's more like Dennis Cosgrove's landscape as the disembodied, aestheticized gaze of the outsider, tourist traveller. The words of the diaries were not slow landscapes by choice, but of necessity, quite different to the more occasional, superficial knowledge of modern visitors and travellers. So in conclusion then, I just say that the historical overview afforded by my father's diaries helps us to realize how mobility and transport are integral to the manner, detail, and diversity of landscape experience. The pedestrian perspective allowed great local landscape engagement to take place. Fast landscapes today are inevitably a more distanciated, disembodied gaze, a more superficial, broad-scale engagement. As Rebecca Solnit puts it, she said, the mind still doesn't absorb a sense of place at any speed much faster than the body moves. Faster than that, at the speed of machines, the world becomes a stage set and only the largest changes register. Only residency entitles one to claim to know a place. So you've got to be from the locality. But she says slow and leisurely progressions like walking give one an inkling.